Maybe more than any other type of infrastructure, railways have a contingent of devoted enthusiasts. Rail fans, as they call themselves. Or should I say ourselves? Maybe it's the nostalgia of an earlier era, or the simple appeal of seeing enormous machinery up close. But railroads and the trains that ride along them are just plain fascinating. Train drivers are often known as engineers, but operating a locomotive is far from the only engineering involved in railways. In fact, building and maintaining a railroad is a big feat, full of complexity. And I'd like to share some of that complexity with you, starting where the rubber meets the road, or in this case, where the steel meets the other steel. It might sound like a simple topic, but don't say that to the attendees of the annual Wheel Rail Interaction Conference. This stuff is complicated, so this is a first in a series of videos I'm doing on the engineering behind railways. Why do the rails of railroads have such a weird shape? The answer is pretty ingenious. I'm Grady, and this is Practical Engineering. In today's episode, we're talking about train wheels and rails. Why do we build railroads anyway? They might seem self-evident now and even kind of elementary, but modern railroads are the result of hundreds of years of innovation. And like many kinds of innovation, the development of railroads was really just a series of solving problems. For example, how can we move upwards of 100 tons per vehicle without tearing up the road in the process? Well, instead of compacted gravel, asphalt, or concrete, we can build the road out of steel. But steel is expensive. So rather than a ribbon, we can save costs by using two narrow steel rails directly below the wheels. But wooden or rubber tires have a lot of rolling resistance because they deform under load, and that resistance adds up with each individual train car. So we use steel for the wheels too. I built this model to show exactly how this works. My wheels are plastic and the rails are aluminum, but I think you'll still get the point. Steel wheels on steel rails are just so much more efficient than... Well, there is the problem of turning, too. Just because you put a rail below a wheel doesn't mean it will follow the same path. You have to have some way for the rail to correct the direction of the wheel and keep it on track, literally. And if you look at railway wheels, the answer is obvious. Flanges. The wheels on railway vehicles all have them. A lip that projects below the rail to guide the wheel as it rolls along, keeping the position side to side. You could put flanges on the outside of wheels like this, but if a horizontal force, like a hard turn, caused one of the wheels to lift, the flange won't help keep the wheel on track. We put flanges on the insides of wheels so they can keep a train from derailing even if one wheel lifts off the track. Let's put some flanges on my wheels and try that demo again. You can see we haven't fully solved the problem. Unlike a wheel that has a tiny contact point with the rail, a flange is a big surface that creates a lot of friction around every curve. If you've heard that characteristic squeal of a train going around a corner, that's the sound of flanges rubbing and grinding along the side of a rail. Rails on tight curves are often made of higher grade, hardened steel compared to straight portions of the track, and sometimes they're even greased up to minimize friction between flanges and the edges of rails. But there's a bigger problem at play in this demonstration than simple friction. Instead of independent wheels, most railway cars use solid axles attached to both wheels called a wheel set. They need that design to withstand the incredible loads each axle carries, but it poses a problem around bends. A solid axle means both wheels turn at the same rate, but the length of the outer portion of track in any given curve is longer than the inside of the curve. Two wheels of the same diameter spinning at the same rate will, kind of obviously, have to roll the same distance. Since there's a mismatch between the distances the wheels need to travel, solid axle wheel sets with cylindrical wheels would always experience some degree of slipping around a turn. That would not only create a bunch of additional friction, but also keep the wheels from following the curved path, and a flange can only do so much. The trick to railway wheels is something that's not so obvious at first glance. The wheels are actually conical. The profile of the wheel is wider on the inside next to the flange and gently narrows toward the outside of the wheel. A wheel set with conical wheels will naturally tend to self-center itself between two rails. On a straight section of track, a wheel that rides up higher on one rail will naturally fall back down, keeping the wheel set roughly centered on the road. In a sense, conical wheels want to stay on the tracks. There's always a little bit of wobble, exaggerated here, so trains actually move down the tracks in a sinusoidal, side-to-side pattern that you can sometimes feel if you're paying attention. Incidentally, that helps the wheels wear evenly, but where it really counts is on a curve. The turning forces on a train cause it to tend toward the outside track. This shifts the wheels over as well. The outer wheel will ride on the thicker part of its tread nearest to the flange, while the inner wheel will ride toward its edge, which has a smaller circumference. This way, the effective diameter of each wheel changes in a curve and solves the slip problem that cylindrical wheels would face. Take a look at the way these conical wheels that I 3D printed behave as they make this corner. You can see the outside wheel rolling on the wider part, effectively increasing its diameter and thus distance traveled per rotation. Conversely, the inside wheel rides on the narrower part of the cone, and so it has a smaller diameter and travels a shorter distance per rotation. It really is kind of ingenious. Most vehicles have a differential gearbox to deal with this challenge of navigating curves. Train cars just use some clever geometry. But that's not the end of the story. You might even be thinking, Richard Feynman already taught me this in the 80s, it's nothing new. But there's more engineering involved in how train wheels and rails interact, including the interesting shape of modern rails. Think about that taper angle first. One standard in the US uses a 1:20 ratio. For the main part of the wheel, that means the outside diameter is roughly 1/4 inch or 6 millimeters less than the inside diameter. And that difference has a big effect on the allowable radius of curves in a railroad. A steeper cone can navigate sharper curves since there's a bigger difference in the circumference from the inside to outside. You can see my wheel set can't navigate this S-curve despite the exaggerated conicity. This challenge is partly solved with trucks, called bogies in the UK. You can kind of think of trucks as big roller skates under each end of a train car. The trucks can rotate relative to the rest of the car, and they usually have some pretty serious springs and suspension systems to keep a smooth ride rolling. Most trucks keep the wheel sets parallel, but some can even allow them to ride radially with each curve. However, even with trucks or bogies, wheels can overshoot their optimal orientation on the tracks. When the simple sinusoidal motion created by the tapered wheels is amplified by the speed of the car, the oscillation can violently slam the truck side to side on the rails. This is called hunting behavior. The violent motion can even cause a train to derail. It's worst with empty cars, and it usually only happens at higher speeds, so a lot of engineering goes into developing wheel profiles and truck designs that raise the hunting onset speed so that it doesn't limit how fast a train can go. That's a lot of innovation on the wheel side, but what about the rails? Just like all parts of a railroad, the rails themselves have evolved over time. Turns out there are a lot of shapes they can take and still serve the same basic function. But modern railway rails are shaped that way for a reason. Weight is equivalent to cost for big steel structures, so there's nothing on these rails that isn't absolutely necessary. In a sense, rails are I-beams, a shape that is well known for its strength and something we see in plenty of other heavy load-bearing steel structures. But there's more to it than that. The bottom part of the rail, called the foot, distributes enormous loads, converting the extreme contact pressure of a steel wheel into something that can be withstood by a wooden or concrete tie. The web elevates the train above the ground, giving clearance for the flanges of the wheels and keeping everything clear of small debris that might end up on the tracks. The head of the rail is where the action happens. This thick, rounded section of steel takes an awful lot of abuse over its life, and thus experiences the bulk of the wear. An old rail section, especially on the high side of a curve, looks remarkably different than a newly forged rail. Here's why. Theoretically, the speed of a spinning wheel exactly matches the speed of the rail at a mathematically precise point. But trains don't care about math. For one, even steel wheels on steel rails deform a little bit as they roll. Rather than a single point, there's a small contact patch between the two. That tiny area, roughly the size of a small coin, carries all the weight of the train into the rail. But because the contact patch is spread across the tapered wheel, the wheel is turning at many different speeds on the same piece of rail. Only the center of the contact patch actually moves at the exact speed of the train. This results in a small amount of grinding as the train moves along, slowly wearing down both the wheel and the rail. Eventually, they start to conform to each other, and that's mostly a bad thing. Wheels can wear down to get a vertical face that wants to climb up the rail, or a hollow profile with a quote-unquote second flange that takes the wrong direction at a switch. Most rail wheels have some amount of hollow to them, which changes how conical they actually are. Some wheels are even designed to be taken off and machined back into spec to extend their life. The best way to reduce this wear is to use hardened materials and reduce the size of the contact patch by curving the top of the rail so that the wheel only touches a tiny part of it as it rolls by. After that, it's just a decision about how much wear you want before needing to replace the rail. The more metal you include in the railhead, the more it will cost, but the longer it will last. In fact, not all rails are equal. The lightest rails are used on straight sections and small commuter service lines. The largest rails are used on curves and heavy-haul freight tracks. Once they get worn down on the main line, they often get reinstalled for a second life in a yard or siding where they can still bear train cars and locomotives at slow speeds. So, rails are shaped in that funny way for a reason. They're bulbous both to reduce the size of the contact patch and provide enough steel to wear away before needing to be replaced. And the shape of rails and wheels is still a topic of research and innovation. Just in the past few years, the standard profile of North American freight train wheels was updated to the new AAR-2A standard. Just a tiny change in the shape of the wheel was tested to have 40% less wear than the previous spec. That means trains will start seeing better steering, lower friction, better fuel consumption, and longer-lasting infrastructure. In many ways, railroads might seem like old technology, a solved problem that doesn't need more engineering, but it's just not true. Modern railroad companies use sophisticated software, like the Train Energy and Dynamics Simulator, to keep track of all the complexities involved in how wheels and rails interact. Simulators can let you adjust factors like train makeup, different track conditions, operating conditions, suspensions, and more to characterize how trains will handle and how much energy they'll use. That's the topic of the next video in this series, so stay tuned if you want to learn more. In the 19th century, railway engineering was all about how to build railroads, finding routes through difficult terrain and efficient forms of construction. Modern rail engineering is all about getting the most out of the system. It might not look like much when you see a train passing by, but a huge amount of research, testing, and engineering went into the shape of those rails and wheels, and we're still improving them today.
Research and testing is something that applies to another part of my life, and maybe yours too, getting kids to eat healthy foods. We recently took a little vacation to a cabin in the woods, but if you have little ones, you know that vacations can be more work than just staying at home. That's partly because of all the meal planning and shopping you have to do. Luckily, we brought HelloFresh, sponsor of this video. This is three meals that I didn't have to plan out or shop for. Plus, the pre-portioned ingredients meant it saved money, and most importantly, I didn't have to worry about bringing home extra food when the ice in our cooler was already melted. That simple box went a long way toward making our trip feel more like the vacation it was meant to be. I do wish I would have remembered to bring a proper knife, though. HelloFresh has a bunch of different plans, and we usually mix it up, but this time we went with the quick and easy options that are simpler and faster to cook. Perfect for a cabin with a limited kitchen. The lack of oven was another unexpected twist, but I was able to pan-fry the crescent roll dough without too much trouble. I tell my friends about HelloFresh because we've been using it for more than 4 years, and it makes our life better, and you might find that's true for you too. Go to HelloFresh.com and use code PRACTICAL16 for 16 free meals plus free shipping. That offers for new subscriptions only and varies by plan across 9 boxes. That's code PRACTICAL16 at HelloFresh.com for 16 free meals. Thank you for watching, and let me know what you think.